It seems like 10 months since we talked last about
yeah,
the movie.
We were in a cabin in a snowy park city.
In a cabin in the snowy park city. And you just sold the movie to a small company.
Very tiny. Yeah.
So do you, how has your 10 months been?
It's been a whirlwind. I mean, it's kind of, it's been a long 10 months because, you know, after the excitement of what happened at Sundance, I've just kind of been sitting on the movie and...
Well, you've kind of taken longer to release the movie than you took to make the movie.
Oh, yeah. Well, I shot another movie in the meantime this past summer, so... It's been a long wait, but it's exciting that it's finally here.
And the new movie has Cher and Angelina Jolie and Brad Pitt.
Is yes, that kind of, not exactly. More the Guy Pearce, Amy Ryan route, but
so you're going for actors? Oh, that.
Oh yes, very talented actors that I'm excited to work with. Yeah.
So what is it like to get Guy Pearce in your face?
Oh, it was awesome.
He's the greatest actor who doesn't ever appear anywhere. He's like Mr. Yeah. He's like he fades away into vapor after he finishes working.
He's a chameleon, and I'm really excited for people to see his performance in this movie because he's so raw and he's so vulnerable in it, and it's a very different character that he's ever played before. So I'm really excited for people to see it.
So he and Amy Ryan are a couple, and they split up, and she goes across the country. And
well, Felicity's in this one as well. Okay. So it's Felicity comes in the middle of some crazy stuff.
Part of your troupe.
Yes, she is definitely part of the troupe. She is. She is in the. Yeah.
Do you feel like an enterprise now? Are you a? Are you a?
I don't know. I'm just trying to make movies. Yeah, exactly. A corporation of once a year films. You know, it's weird because it's, you know, the films are really just an expression of what I'm thinking about and how I'm feeling at the time. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's just great to be able to keep making them. Really.
So is that what you want to do? Is that your once a year?
Well, the last 4 years.
Are you next Woody Allen?
No one will be Woody Allen. But it's been fun to just continue to do it. So
you're just dating younger as you go.
We started one in 2009, 2010, 2000, and then we just did one summer. So yeah.
So that'll be next year.
Yeah, next year we'll be done in spring with the cut, and then hopefully.
So when do you start the next one?
I don't know. I haven't started thinking about what the next one is yet. So.
So I assume you wrote the new one.
Yes, with Ben York Jones, who's been here.
Yes.
Little douchebag.
Little douchebag.
Younger douchebag brother.
So will you continue douchebagging? Is that your? Is that? I mean, do you think you'll ever take anybody else's script and?
I'd love to.
I'm sure they've been feeding them to you lately. No.
Yeah, the problem is I can't find anything I love. So. I'm sort of waiting for the right project. So in the meantime, just doing these improv movies from the outlines.
What is that?
These movies are all improvised.
Oh, these are all improvised.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Douchebag.
Yeah.
Like crazy, and then the new one is highly improvised from a very specific outline that outlines exactly what's going on in the story.
Huh. So does Amy have?
Amy's improvising, Guy's improvising.
Do they have improvising backgrounds or experience?
Well, Amy's,
or
you know, yes, she has a lot.
Amy's
of
a great theater actress, but I don't remember her improvising.
Yeah, I think it comes very natural to her. And Guy, it was a very different experience for him and something he's never done before, so it was interesting. And then he's improvising in a foreign dialect. He's improvising in an American dialect, so just incredible to watch him work because there's really nobody better. He's incredible.
As you are now, because I know you have a foreign accent. You just hide.
Yeah, I do. I'm actually British. I'm just
do the fake American thing. Just to get in the door.
Can you hear it?
It shows up every once in a while when you say words with a lot of R's in them.
Yes, yes.
Sneaks on through.
Yeah.
So you've been waiting on the movie. Is it nice to have the distraction of the other movie, or is it...
It was.
Having two things at once too much, or...
Well, now it's a little too much, and it's a little weird, because we're cutting the movie, and I'm traveling, promoting like crazy, so it's a little bit strange.
You're promoting like crazy, like crazy.
I'm promoting like crazy, like crazy, yes. But it was nice. I mean, waiting 10 months and sort of getting comfortable or feeling satisfied with the situation would have killed me, really, in a way. Having to get back to work and having the challenge of trying a new genre on a much bigger budget level and different actors and a different story was really challenging and exciting and really made me feel like I could, you know, focus on something else, which I needed to do. So.
And is the form work in that kind of, in a new genre and another, in a different level? Is that?
It does, but it changes. I mean, it's never the same. I mean, the actors are different, so the process has to change a little bit every time. It can't be exactly the same every time.
So do you think you can expand that?
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, I think Like Crazy was a little bit of a looser film in a way.
Right.
There wasn't as much, you know, story or conflict. It was really about finding the intimacy between two people and sort of wanting it to be fresh and finding the spontaneity in that relationship. And mm-hmm. in the new film, it's much more plot heavy and it's sort of a romantic thriller in a way. It's a much darker film. It's like a darker cousin to Like Crazy almost. Mm-hmm. So with that, it was a little more structured, which was different for Felicity and I have worked together before in a much looser environment. So in that movie, it was more structured just by virtue of having more money, more people on set and a bigger story.
So would you imagine it'll get more and more structured and you'll keep trying to hang on to it?
I think this is just the perfect amount of structure, what we just did. So
don't raise your budgets anymore.
No, that's the highest. Yeah.
Well, you're laughing, but because I know that there's some of the people who've gone from the indie stuff, the small stuff, to the bigger level with the studios are like, I don't know, a little too much.
Yeah.
Too many trailers.
Yeah, no, it felt pretty big. I mean, on Like Crazy, we didn't have any trailers. We didn't have, you know, I mean, we had one makeup person doing makeup and hair. And on the new movie, we had this giant, you know, giant three bangers and things like that. And it just felt really weird. It felt a little too corporate at times. So it's nice to just sort of feel like you're off on your own making your little movie and no one cares and you're under the radar. Something exciting about that. You feel like you have something to prove. And when you're making more of a real movie, it feels a little more like you're kind of in line with everything else that's going on in the world. And there's something that's not as exciting about that process, I feel like.
So are you running out of stuff? You're so focused on filmmaking the last few years?
Yeah, I'm not living enough life to...
I don't know.
Yeah, no, that's a concern. I'm hopefully going to take a couple of months in the beginning of the year and... do a little bit of traveling.
You mean during the award season?
Yeah.
So you really don't want any awards because you can take a vacation, God forbid.
My goal is for as many people to see the movie as possible, and that's it. Whatever else happens, happens. But yes, at some point, I definitely need to...
But it could really fuck up your vacation.
Yes.
Your nominations for things.
Yeah, hopefully none of that happens. That would be...
I'd be so much happier if none of that happened.
Yes, exactly. I get to relax.
And then you don't have to come back here anymore. So.
Yeah, exactly. I come here every October, and then I see you every January, so...
There you go. It's a weird thing.
It is weird. It is weird. We've done... This is our fourth time.
My God. We're getting old together.
We are.
Or I'm getting older than you. I started older than you, so... really getting old together.
Yeah.
So are you... Is this like the best time of your life, or are you kind of like, okay, now I've got where I'm where I want to be, and now I'm just kind of gotta push and push and push?
No, it is the best time of my life, but it's also the scariest and strangest time of my life because I don't really have a balance anymore. I'm just sort of kind of floating out in the ether, constantly working on the movies or constantly promoting the movie. So I was in New York all summer shooting the movie, living there, and then I've been on the road for this all over the world, London, Rome, East Coast, West Coast, everywhere. Mm-hmm. So there's no normalcy in my life, which is a great problem to have, and I'm blessed to have it, but I feel strange. I feel like a bit of a mess in a way, but that's, you know, kind of exciting too because there's so many new things happening.
What's another movie?
It is a movie, yeah, absolutely. But it's hard to maintain your personal life, your relationships with friends. When you're just so consumed by your work, it's difficult to maintain, you know, normal relationships with parents and friends and things like that. So that's a little weird.
So can you lose on Like Crazy? I mean, is at this point, there's been kind of this wave of love. There's been this, you know, real outpouring besides Paramount being there and promoting and doing all the stuff they're doing.
Yeah,
there has been a real, you know, passion about your people and yourself. And have you already kind of won this battle, and then the box office, you know, will be whatever it is? And
I think so. I mean, just considering the fact that we made the movie for $250,000 and it's getting as wide a release as it's getting between now and Thanksgiving is winning right there. I mean, really, at the end of the day, you know, the movie's so personal and it comes from my heart that as many people as I can share it with and as many people that are affected by it as possible, that's the most exciting thing. And that's what excites me about this process.
You're getting sick of talking about it?
You know, I do at times, to be honest, but then again, like, everyone's different. Everyone's got a different perspective and audiences are different. So I just try to think about that, and that inspires me, and I can sort of, it's fresh again.
So, but Felicity's probably a little tired.
Well, she's really tired. She's done, I think, two movies, a play, and then this, which has been nuts. She's been everywhere, and I think she's doing Ellen today. And
we saw her on the out at the Four Seasons on the lawn yesterday, posing. It was beautiful.
Yeah, she's been doing a lot of posing this year.
And are you doing the GQ cover?
I am. I'm doing the GQ cover with Anton. We're going to be on this pole, and it'll be great.
People can't actually see the pole, but
that's true. Well, that's not good.
Well, pretend it's not here. Yeah. Well, you know, there's a firehouse downstairs.
Oh yeah, exactly.
That's why we have the pole. Exactly. Dennis Leary lives downstairs. Yeah. Very screwed up. But yeah, it must be. I mean, you are. You get exhausted with, you know, your personal life. You have to, like, what's home and what's not. But you're traveling more with Felicity than you probably have traveled with any, or and Anton a bit. And
yeah, well, they're wonderful.
Anybody you've ever known.
They're wonderful people, and they're easy to be around. So
it's a road trip from hell.
Well, thankfully we get to spend some time apart and stuff. But it's great watching audiences react to their performances in the film. Is just so special and so cool. So it makes it easy when people really respond.
So you're not having Felicity in your cutting room? I'm confused.
Yeah, exactly. She'd be interesting in the cutting room. She wouldn't want me to use any of her tanks if she was in the cutting room.
She wouldn't want you to.
Yeah, she'd be like, you can't use any of that. I don't like me in any of that. She's so picky about herself. But then when she watches the film all put together, she goes, yeah, okay, I get it. But she has a hard time watching herself.
Is Anton picky?
Anton doesn't give a shit about anything. He's kind of a nice.
He does seem like the most kind of laid back human being.
He's very laid back. Yeah, I think at times. I mean, he would be more concerned if there was a moment that he didn't feel like he was fully in character, mm-hmm. or there was a moment where he didn't feel like he did what he wanted to do in the moment. But other than that, like, he's not very vain. He doesn't care what he looks like. He doesn't care. He's just like, he's so intense and he just wants to get after the work.
So. Do you think that's what draws? Do you think that's what other people have come on the new movie, for instance, to come to you to do? That actors are now being drawn to the Drake experience.
I think the process is unique to the point that I think actors find it very liberating and they want to be a part of it. So when this movie came up this past summer, I met with a lot of different actors and had a lot of great meetings, and it was just really exciting to see people. To see Like Crazy really resonate with actors, and for them to read the outline and then see the film and really see how it sort of works, where we go from this that's sort of 50 pages of a very specific idea, but the scene's not fully formulated, and then going to the final product, I think really excites actors. And
so is that part of your casting process, that you give them the?
Yeah, well, I want them to understand where it starts and where it ends, so that they can sort of trust the process and not try to hold on or stifle it or control the process, because the most important thing about it is to understand your character and understand the emotional journey of the scene and then give yourself to it and just be vulnerable with it, not try to control it or direct it or push it.
So did you, I mean, in developing this, I know you have the improv background, the improv life.
Yes.
But it's unusual to stick with it. I mean, Chris Guest went through 30 years of doing everything else in the world before he ended up doing those movies that were improvised. Is it something that you just started to work, so therefore you've continued with it? Or is it something you said, okay, I have this vision of how to make movies and this is the style?
Yeah, it's really weird. I mean, because I started when I made Splinter, which was my first feature, which I didn't really know what I was doing. I mean, I was still learning and still young, and it was scripted and there was a little bit of improv, but there was something that didn't quite fully gel for me about the process, but I learned a lot and it was a great experience. And then on Douchebag, I really sort of was like, okay, I think this is really what I'm more interested in doing now. And then doing that project, it started to make a little more sense. And then with Like Crazy, I think it solidified, okay, this is how I want to work. And I've learned enough about the process now that I can continue to explore and make movies that sort of work for me. So yes, it's been a really organic process. It's not like I woke up one day and said, okay, this is how I want to do it, and this is how I have to do it, and this is the only way to do it. It just sort of worked for me, and it came out of a process of doing a lot of experimentation with different styles of filmmaking, and really kind of solidified itself as the right thing for me.
The fact that this is all emerged from Douchebag has got to be like the poster for do what you want to do, well, name what you want to name, you know?
Yeah, well, I mean, that movie was made for $25,000, and
who would have fucking thought it?
That movie is a huge success in so many ways, just because we did sell the movie for a lot more than it cost, and it did come out in a couple cities. And even though that many people didn't see it, I'm still very proud of the film and proud of how the experience went and brought me to where I am today.
Well, I assume Like Crazy may not have happened without Douchebag.
No way. Yeah. Like Crazy never would have happened without Douchebag. No way. Absolutely.
And the next one, and the next one.
Absolutely. I mean, it's exciting to go do them quickly, because the ideas of what worked and what didn't are so fresh in my mind. So it's easy to just kind of go, okay, well, let's go. You know, let's go. Let's go do it better. Really, every time out is the goal.
So do you think you'd want to go to other countries to do it?
Yeah, well, we went, you know, we went to London for like crazy, which was great.
Right.
You know, we shot there for a little while. And
then like go settle down in Argentina for a month? And
I'd love to do that. If the story called for it, if the right story comes up, I'd love that. Yeah.
Because you can kind of like define your universe in this.
Absolutely.
Methodology and figure out the actors that are in other places and, you know.
I mean, anything's possible at this point. That's what's exciting is I really do feel like if I have an idea and I want to shoot something in a couple of months, there's enough trust now with the camp around me that they'll jump if I say jump. And that's what's exciting is when I'm inspired to work, I want to do something, and I have the opportunity to do that, and I feel like the luckiest filmmaker in the world.
Well, you're kind of the opposite of the indie paranoia of the moment. Yeah. You know, that nothing can happen and there's no money and it's never going to work.
Yeah.
I mean, does that world touch you? Do you?
Yeah.
Are you conscious of all the angst out there about distribution and everything else?
I am, but at the same time, I think it's important not to worry about that and tell stories mm-hmm. from the heart and make sure that they're as personal as possible, because there is a natural filtration process, and I think audiences can suss out what's false and what's true. And I think in mm-hmm. independent cinema, the most important thing is that the filmmaker believes in the film that they're making and that it's true and real. And as long as you do that, there's something to be said for it. So, I don't know. I mean, I think a lot of filmmakers let budget get in the way
mm-hmm.
and they sort of hold on to a number, and that's the number. And unless they have that, they can't make their film. And mm-hmm. that, you know, that sort of stops them from making what they want to make. And, you know, for me, my MO was always, let's make it for as cheap as we can, but also continue to have the integrity that the film needs to have. So, you know.
Well, that's kind of the funny thing with you is that you, from the beginning, as I recall, have been on this kind of very conscious of what the reality is of the world. You're not a flighty, you know, artiste who's just, I mean, you are an artist, but you're not a, you know, you're not a, I'm above it and I'm, you know, don't care about all those things. You've always been very conscious of what the business is.
Yeah.
While you're doing these things that are actually pushing the envelope for the business a bit.
Yeah, I mean, it's changing. Every year it's changing. Mm-hmm. I mean, just even thinking back at Sundance this year and Sundance last year, I was there 2 years in a row in competition with Douchebag. When I was there, nothing was selling. I mean, it just wasn't happening.
Right.
You know, and then this year, everything started selling. I mean, I think 40 movies sold to big studios this year at Sundance, which was like, I mean, suddenly it's back, you know, suddenly people are taking chances, and it's like, you know, it's incredible how it changes, and you never know what's going to happen.
Well, it's a weird balancing act because the studio, I mean, you are the, I guess, the penultimate, ultimate. Mm. You're the ultimate story this year at Sundance, and that major studio picked you up. And then Searchlight's picked up a bunch of these small movies also, kind of shockingly, mm-hmm. I think to everybody, continually shockingly. Mm-hmm. But then there's kind of like the rest of the distribution channels are a little blurrier, I'd say. It's a very... It's like both thrilling and horrifying at the same time because it's hard to tell what the future is.
Such a drop between there's the big studios, and then there's all this air in between, and then there's the tiny distributors that don't really have enough money to back a film.
Yeah.
And then those films just sort of come and go, and no one really knows about them.
So even film company like IFC can generate, you know, $4 or $5 million for a movie.
Sure.
With like $1.5 million in theatrical and $3.5 million in VOD, and you know that's something, but it's not.
But for some films, that's great.
Yeah.
And that's, you know. Shit, I mean, that's, you know, for me, I mean, I, you know.
That would have been good on Douchebag.
Absolutely, no, it's, you know, every film has its own journey, and every film needs the right distributor, and, I mean, it's just, it's fascinating to me, because I've learned so much this year just in dealing with Paramount, and how incredibly supportive they've been, and how behind the movie they are, and how excited they are to put it out there, so.
So are you mentoring people now, is that your...
Yeah, right. Yeah, I need the mentoring still. I'm still...
Well, I mean, is there that sense? Are you finding that people who know who you are, who are, you know, looking for an idea of how to do what you've done?
Yeah, a little bit here and there. I mean, it's more of the Facebook thing. It's so funny how often people either want to talk about their long-distance relationship or about film and how to get a movie made.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like all day, you know, I'm responding to about 20 messages a day to people who want to tell me about their story, how about how they went back and forth between Montreal and New York for 5 years and then now they're married, or this happened or that happened. I mean, it's crazy. People want to share their stories.
We had that conversation at your publicity company yesterday.
Oh, yeah?
One of the people who works there who's not involved, not, you know, handling your movie, but she's like, this is my story.
Oh, at
42 West,
Oh, yeah. That's great.
I can't wait
was
to
it
see
you?
It. No. But it's like, he knew something. He could tell my story.
Well, that's the funny thing is people, that's what people come up and say all the time. It's like, that's my story. You told my story. And I said, well, great. I didn't know I was telling your story, but that's awesome. I mean, it's a very universal thing. And I think when we were making the film, I had no idea that it was that universal.
So when did you get an inclination? When did you get the idea that was actually happening?
Pretty much right away at Sundance. I mean, I had a...
people were stopping you on the bus?
I was walking off the stage after doing the Q&A at the premiere, and one of the presidents of one of the main studios that we did not sell the movie to came up to me and just said, I just made an offer on your film. Literally, as I was walking off the stage. And I mean, you know, with Douchebag, it took months for us to find a distributor after Sundance. And this guy, I'm walking off the stage, and this guy came up to me and said, and I said, well, this is different. You know, just in thinking that, yeah, it's a growth from Douchebag, but it's, you know, I certainly wasn't expecting anything like that. So I think right away I realized that, and he told me, he said, well, that my relationship with my wife before we were in LA together, she was in New York and I was in LA and back and forth for 4 or 5 years. And he said that is exactly what it feels like. And that's exactly the emotional journey. And it hit me so hard, and I want that movie. And then we spent the next 14 hours in a room, sort of in this bidding war situation with all these studios, and then ended up with an incredible partner in Paramount at the end of the day. So
that's actually how Michael Barker and Tom Bernard got together as a pair.
Really?
Long distance relationship? No, I'm kind of making it up. It was actually their true story.
Oh, yeah.
So what was it like after Sundance? Was there like did you have to come down off of the high?
It was weird. I mean, Sundance is the best 10 days no matter what, you know. It's so exciting. It's so exciting. And I pretty much just had a week of depression in the beginning of February. And then I was like, okay, we got to go do this again. Huh. So pretty much right away, I knew that I wanted to make another film this summer.
So what were you depressed about?
Oh, I don't know. I just love being around other filmmakers and seeing other films and being inspired and making films. And it's hard to take a break. I like to just constantly be working on something. So.
And I saw you during the award season at parties and stuff, and just saw you kind of floating around the room. You know? You all seem to be like 6 inches off the ground. You were kind of like, there goes Drake.
It's been a fairy tale. I mean, dream come true. I mean, you work really hard and you try to tell stories you care about, but to have what's happened to me this year is, I mean, I am unbelievably fortunate.
So you'll be improvising Star Trek 2?
With Anton.
Anton's approved you for the gig. Yeah. Would that something like that interest you? Are you interested in that kind of getting into the mechanics of doing something that affects-y and complicated? And
yeah, I mean, I love movies like that have a really good love story at the core. Like a movie like Fifth Element is something that I could totally see myself getting involved in at some point. It's just got to be the right story at the right time in my life that I'm ready to tell and that I'm right to tell. Because the last thing I want to do is get on board somebody's project and ruin it by not being where I need to be to make it or the right person to make it. So
you don't see yourself becoming a mechanic in any way? You don't see that part of the... Well, I mean, there's something, Tony Scott is a brilliant mechanic. He's, you know, kind of a genius at it. And, you know, when it works, sometimes the script doesn't work, sometimes it does. But when it does, this stuff, like, just blows you away.
Yeah.
But you don't see yourself in that world.
I don't know. I'm just taking one movie at a time, and you never know what's going to happen. But, I see myself as a person that goes and makes the movies that he wants to make and doesn't really care if money people or studio people think I'm doing it wrong. I have a story to tell, and I'm going to tell it, and I'm going to fight for that vision, and that's how I do it. So if that's in the studio context on a bigger scale one day, then great. But right now, I don't know.
Well, it must be kind of fun to be the little guy, where are you? You're not the little film. Paranormal just came out.
Yeah, I know.
And the budget's probably even smaller than your next movie and made all this money, so.
Yeah, well, there you go.
Anything can happen.
Well. Yeah, that's very true.
So will you be nervous on opening day this time around?
I'm going to be in Rome, actually. I'm leaving at 9 a.m. on Friday to go. We're doing a Rome Film Festival on Saturday night, so. I'm excited to go out there, but yes, I'm
nervous. You get to see Tintin.
Yes, I'm not going to be here opening weekend. It's scary, but hopefully people will check it out.
But you have an international cell, and they'll be able to call you with numbers every 12 minutes? Is that?
Yeah, exactly. Every 10 minutes, I want to know what's going on. No, I mean, you know, hopefully, it's only on 4 screens this weekend. It's going to be in New York and LA, and then by Thanksgiving, it'll be kind of all over the country, so it's... it's exciting.
It is a happy Thanksgiving movie, coming together.
yeah. a holiday treat like crazy.
It's like they're selling the girl with the dragon tattoo as, you know, the Christmas movie of all time.
Yeah, that's great. That's right. Well, they always put the serious dark movies on Christmas Day, don't they?
So will you get the, I mean, are you going to get an email about East Coast matinees? Or are you interested? Do you just want to kind of know what happens on Saturday morning? What happened yesterday? Or how focused are you?
You know, not that much. I mean, you know, thankfully there's a whole team of people that are more concerned with that than I am. And as far as I'm concerned, it's not my, you know, that's not my job. And I think they're doing a great job creating awareness. And thankfully the reviews have been fabulous for the film. And I think it's really touching people. So, you know, whatever happens, happens, really. At the end of the day, I'm just excited to continue to do Q&As and talk to people about their stories and explain my process. And That's what I'm focused on right now still. So
have you met Mike Lee yet? Or?
I have not, but I met Mike Mills the other night at the Hollywood Film Festival Awards. I think he's fantastic, and that was really cool.
Yeah. Well, he doesn't work exactly like what you were.
No, not at all. I'm just saying someone that I think made a great film this year.
But it'd be interesting to like meet some of the people who work in that, more closer to what you're doing.
Oh, yeah. Well, I did meet Guest a couple of years ago, and that was a treat. He's cool. Yeah.
Very dry.
Oh, yes. Yes. Very, very talented. Talk about chameleons. Oh, holy cow. Yeah.
I worked with him years ago and thought he hated my guts because he just always had that look on his face.
Yeah. Like, it's great. Okay.
It turns out he just didn't know who I was. It was fine. It was much better that way. So how many times do you actually watch the movie with an audience?
I stopped at Toronto. That was my last time. That was the last time I've seen it with an audience. Probably seen it with an audience 20 times.
So you're in Rory Thompson Hall for yours, or you're in L?
We were in the Ryerson.
The Ryerson.
Yeah,
so that's a
great.
Good room.
Great room. It was a packed, rowdy college sort of...
See, it feels like a college. Yeah. Like, there are no college kids in there because they can't afford to go to the thing. But it feels like a college still.
Yeah. It was cool. That was by far our rowdiest screening. They were really loud and into it. But
so has it been a different response in different places, or is it
somewhat? But it's also been, I think because the film is so universal, audiences for the most part have reacted mostly the same to the film. I mean, what's exciting is that older audiences sort of look back nostalgically on what it feels like to be infatuated with your first love, and people who are going through it now can really relate to it because it's happening. And then the younger audiences, the teen audiences, can relate to it in the sense that they long to feel that way about somebody, and they long to have a relationship like that. So what's been incredible is that we've sort of found just that there really is no audience that we can't quite get to. So and the cool thing too is it's for men. It's not saccharine. It's not overly sentimental. It's a love story, but it's very true and it's very raw. So it's not something that you should be afraid of coming to if you're a guy and your girlfriend is dragging you to see it.
So Like Crazy is like the Viagra of the award season. You should put that on posters for the Academy.
Yeah. Sounds good.
See Like Crazy, get it up, go along.
Yeah.
Are you being signaled? It's okay.
She's laughing.
So see, you like a good audience.
She's laughing at your joke.
Oh, good. So well, then I like it on good audience.
Your joke through her.
Wow. Character. It's a beautiful prism.
Yeah.
It's a prism of love.
Yes, it is.
Oh, God. So what else is going on?
Just cutting the new movie right now. And
so you like cutting?
That's my favorite part. I mean,
really?
I can relax and sort of find it. I mean, I have so much footage that I can do so many different things with every scene because there's so many different versions of things we've shot. So it really is rewriting the film, and it really is realizing what it is.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a really satisfying process.
So do you feel like you found this one yet, or are you still kind of looking?
No, very, very much still in the finding process. A lot of work to do. We have many months ahead of grinding it out, but we'll get there. And I'm really proud of it. And
well, it sounds like you're excited about it. It sounds like
whatever
footage you're looking at, you must be very happy.
Yeah, I mean, it was a very different thing for me. It was a much higher budget level. It was a much different tone.
And how does that manifest for you? I mean, are you seeing more complex cinematography, or does it look better, or does it...
It's more the scope of it, really, more than anything. I mean, we have scenes where we have, you know, hundreds of extras and things like that, and many more locations, and the story is a bigger story, and I just think it's really cool to just kind of try something on a bigger scale, essentially, with still trying to maintain the same process.
So are all 100 extras improvising, are they?
Yeah, all five. I have one scene with 500 extras in a concert hall, and they're all improvising all at once.
So were those 500 hired extras, or did you just open up?
No, we did it legit. This movie shot up in upstate New York, and everything was done It was like a real movie. Yeah, it was
scary.
It was scary, but it's also exciting because it really felt like the next thing in the evolution of what I needed to do. So it was perfect for me.